Our first speaker is one of the best-known copywriters in the country. He's written campaigns for some of the UK's leading brands, and he's also the author of many excellent books about copywriting and freelancing. Here to talk to us about the timeless techniques of direct marketing, it's the spiritual successor to Drayton Bird, Andy Maslen.
Morning, everyone. No pressure there then, Tom. I have a confession to make. I make my living writing junk mail. And I have another confession to make. I enjoy it. Now, I'm a fellow of the Institute of Direct Marketing, and presumably that at this moment there's a marksman somewhere over there getting me in his crosshairs for calling it junk mail. And we're supposed to call it direct mail, aren't we? So why do I call it junk mail? Because that's what our reader calls it. I have yet to meet a professional person or a milkman or the guy who washes the windows of our office in Salisbury who says, oh, I got a very interesting piece of direct mail this morning. It's a very writer-centric view of the world to talk about what we do as direct mail. You know, the moment you start calling it junk mail, you realise just exactly how much value the marketplace, the customer, the reader, places on what you're doing. And that sets the bar pretty high. Now, over the last 30-odd years, I've learned a reasonable amount about copywriting, mostly through direct response. I mean, I write annual reports and websites and all kinds of things, but it's the direct mail, the junk mail, that's my first love. So what I want to do is share with you just a few lessons that I've learned over the years about what we can pick up from direct response copywriting. And in fact, I did dig out my first mail shot, my first piece of junk mail that I wrote in about late May 1986. I'll be able to show you that later. Can I have a show of hands first of all? I know it's early in the morning, so everyone's going to do this when I ask you to do it. So I want a big confident copywriting show of hands like this, not a sort of librarian one like that. If you agree with me that copywriting is all about words, let's have a show of hands.
Blimey. You've seen what's on
screen. So, who put that up? Okay, so prepared joke number one didn't go down so well. Moving swiftly along, it may come as no surprise to you, Len, that I don't think copywriting is all about words. Perhaps if that hadn't been there, we would have had a few more hands in the air. See me later. And certainly, you know, if you look at freelance copywriters' websites in particular, there's a great emphasis on words. I love words. You know, ever since I won a poetry competition when I was five, I've always loved words, and here it is. You know, ever since I did my degree in English literature, I've always had a passion for words. And it bothers me slightly because I don't think our customers particularly, or our employers, have a passion for words. They have a passion for something else. The first thing that I learned as a copywriter, is that copywriting is about numbers. And it's about one number in particular. It's about the number you get when you add up all your sales and you take away all your costs. And this number, for the more sort of financially astute members of the audience, is called gross profit. And it's a really wonderful number because the more of it you have, the more things you can buy or invest. You can pay your staff, you can buy a new sports car, you can do whatever you want to do with it. There are a lot of companies, there are a lot of copywriting companies, there are certainly a ton of advertising agencies and advertisers who forgot this basic lesson that copywriting in particular and marketing in general is not about creativity or, as I was asked to judge an award a couple of years ago, creative bravery. I mean, what the fuck is creative bravery? You know, I have friends in Salisbury who go out and lead battalions of bomb disposal people to Afghanistan. That is bravery in my book. Deciding to do a pink envelope instead of a white one. So, let me tell you about my first job as a copywriter. I was a marketing assistant for a little publishing company, not too far from here, actually. And I had a very simple job. My job was to write junk mail to sell reports to executives. So it's what we call B2B copywriting, business to business. Every morning, the directors and the two or three of us who worked in the marketing department would go downstairs to the reception area and watch while the receptionist opened the post. Now, at that time, we used to print all our mail shots on different coloured paper. So you'd have, mine were blue, and Jane's were white, and Shona's were orange, or whatever it might be. And basically, she would arrange these piles of orders like a sort of three-dimensional histogram. And what we were told, and what I learned, was the bigger the pile of order forms, the better the copywriter. And if your pile was the highest, you were the best. That was it. That was what we learned. There was another pile, incidentally, which was the pile of checks, which was even more interesting and probably the subject of a different speech. So everything that I was schooled in from the very first day was about trying to make this pile of order forms grow higher. And you know, if you could do that, you were given pay rises and promotions. The wheels came off when I was so good that they made me a marketing director. Now I was probably the last person they should have ever promoted to a management role, because I used to go and sneak off and write copy when I should have been doing spreadsheets. Happily, it led to me being a sort of 52-year-old marketing assistant, which is the sort of job I do now. The other story that I remember, they sort of burned into my sort of memory even now, is I had just got a new piece of junk mail back from the printers, file copies we call them, still wet. You could sort of smell the ink off the litho press. I was very excited because I think it was the first brochure I'd been allowed to produce that had two colour print. I mean, we were going back a little way here. And I went rushing up the stairs to the marketing director's office, burst in on him. There he was behind his desk, probably doing spreadsheets, I should think. And I went, Trevor, look what I've done. And I sort of presented this glossy green and white brochure to him. And he sort of looked up from his, and he went, how many have you sold? And I went, none. It's only come back from the printers. And he went, So I sort of, it's very difficult for a 3-inch tall person to get down some tall stairs. But that was the other big lesson that I learned, is don't come and show me something you like because you think it's creative. Come and show me something that's making me, one of the shareholders of the business, a ton of money. Another number that we were told was very important was this one here, response rate. Conversion rate, if you prefer. Basically, for every 100 letters that we sent out, how many orders came back the other way. And believe it or not, as long as I could fail 99% of the time, everyone was incredibly pleased with me. This, well done, 99% failure rate, let's have a pay rise. Because it turns out that at 1%, everything was incredibly profitable. Which means that if you can increase it to 1.1% or 1.2%, or heaven forbid, 2%, this is all going straight to the bottom line. That number, when you take away your cost from your sales, now starts looking extremely healthy. And I'll talk a little bit about this later, about what we try to do to make that number go up. Then we have, I only heard about it from Romy quite recently. We used to just call it return on investment, but at any rate, return on marketing investment. In other words, if I give you this much money to spend, this is how much money I expect back. And again, it was a very simple number. I was told, and I think this went for everybody, for every pound that you spend, I want five back. I being the shareholders of the business. In other words, we are going to give you some of our money, and you are going to turn it into more money than we started with. And it took me quite a while to answer this question in my head. Well, why can't I just bring you back £2? Surely that's a pound profit. And they gently explained to me that, well, we've got an editorial department and a production department and a finance department and the receptionist who opens the post and the expenses of running a company generally and overheads and all the rest of it. So if you only make us £2, we haven't got enough. But if you can make us five, everyone's happy. So we had to make a 400% return on investment, which again focuses the mind wonderfully on things like what kind of format of brochure you're going to use, how much paper you're going to print. You know, if you're going to write a long sales letter, well, that's going to cost more than a short one. And now as a agency boss, we do a lot of work at my company with big publishers, people like the BBC, Radio Times, Reader's Digest, those sorts of outfits, who still, believe it or not, do an awful lot of direct mail, junk mail, old school. And they are very interested in this number CPA, which is cost per acquisition. In other words, how much is it going to cost us to get a new subscriber to the Radio Times? And that's not far off it, actually. You know, whenever I do a sort of back of the envelope calculation, you're looking at around about £35 to buy a new subscriber. The interesting number to compare it to is the cost per retention. In other words, if you've got this person in for £35, how much do you have to spend to hold on to them? And it turns out to be about £5. In other words, it's 7 times more expensive to find a new customer than it is to hold on to your existing one, which is why we always advise anyone in a sort of membership organisation or anyone with repeat purchases or subscriptions, get your renewal process sorted out first. Now, if you've got a bucket with a bloody great hole in the bottom, you can fill it up as fast as you like with new subscribers, but all the water's coming out the bottom. So it's best to sort of weld a plate over that hole first before you start doing the big glamorous acquisitions campaign. And everybody, this is very specific to publishing, but everybody in publishing gets terribly excited about TV and press and acquisition. They call it new business. New business sounds very exciting. You find out that the what's called the renewal series, all the effort you're going to make to hang on to your existing customers is given to the intern or maybe just your mailing house, who send out a letter in sort of dried blood-coloured ink that says something like, we regret to inform you your subscription is about to end. Please send us £30. And then they wonder why they're losing one out of every two customers. You know, with one company I work with, they were spending something like £1.5 million a year on acquisitions, and they had a 50% renewal rate. In other words, every year they were pissing away £750,000 on people that they weren't holding on to. So, I think copywriting is about numbers. It's not all about words any more than art is about paint. Words are our materials, if you like. Grammar and spelling and syntax and punctuation are our tools. But, you know, art is about truth and beauty and the human condition. And what I was told was that copywriting was about behavior modification. My first boss said to me, you're in the business of modifying people's behavior, usually to buy something. So let's just, there's the clicker. I've been given very strict instructions about this. There's a green button and a red button, but they both make the slides go forward. We are not a hive mind. Human beings are gregarious. We're a sort of herd animal. But we're not bees. We're not ants. We're not the Borg. We don't have some sort of collective consciousness. And where you often see a piece of copy going wrong is where the writer has lost sight of this. They've spent so much time thinking about their list, for example, or the audience, this dreadful word, audience, that they start to imagine, as I have here, that everybody I'm writing to is sitting in front of me, very sweetly and passively, listening and lapping up every word that I have to say. But again, if you think back to this idea of junk mail, I don't think that's, you know, that's what the world looks like at all. David Ogilvy, who's, you know, one of my heroes, along with people like Bill Birnbach and others going way back, said, do not address your readers as if they were gathered together in a stadium. When they read your copy, they are alone. And this is something I think direct response copywriters find very easy, because it's a very intimate form of communication. You're usually writing a letter, and I'm going to use that as my default because it could be an email, but you're writing a letter to somebody. So there is somehow this sense of intimacy that it is a one-to-one communication. Where it all goes wrong, and this is the symptom to watch out for, is you see this phrase, some of you. And what's happened is the writer is thinking, well, I've got this list of 200,000 people on, you know, that I'm going to write to. Now, I know that half of them are existing customers and know all about our amazing solution, and the other half don't. So what they write down is, and I've probably done this myself, some of you will know about our amazing solution. And I would think, who is this some of me? You know, this is me and my multiple personalities sort of bickering about, well, I knew about it, well, I didn't. So the simplest trick that you pull, and you all know, you just use the what is it called, the second person singular, you. The moment you refer to your reader as you, and I think this works on a billboard, incidentally, as well as the mail shot, there is only one person reading, because you is always the reader. Now, here's a... I've prepared a little sort of diagram that illustrates the way I think many, what should we call them, amateur or... not us lot, anyway, all those other ones, see the world. Here's me the copywriter. Here's my audience. And what my job is to communicate my messages, to sort of promulgate my messages out to my audience. And I don't think that's quite the way the world works. I think the diagram is virtually perfect, but I think it's mislabeled. So this is how I think it should be look, how it should look. Ah. Now, me is still at the center of the universe, and audience alert, non-rhetorical question coming up. Who is me? It's so obvious, nobody's going to say it, but I'm not going to carry on talking until someone says it. The customer, thank you. It's the reader, isn't it? We are all at the center of our own universe. And in fact, what's interesting is that you think of your own life for a moment. What are the things that really matter to you? Well, it's probably your job, your family, your values, your pets, if you have pets, money worries or saving money, holidays, friends, all the rest of it, if your kids are doing the 11 plus or going off to university. Let's just think for a moment about where all of us lot are. Well, junk mail is in the sort of stratosphere, somewhere over here. If you're in e-marketing, or you think you are, you're writing spam. If you're in the corporate world, you're writing marketing bollocks. It says speak, but I like swearing in public. And I don't know if Mr. Trott has arrived yet, but he gets let off light. This just says advertising. Because of the great sort of creativity in advertising, a lot of people have quite a lot of respect and they don't call it by rude names. But certainly, this is what I do. You know, I get shunned in the playground at school on the school run when I tell them what I do for a living. So this gives you an idea, I think, of the challenge you face as a writer. If you're trying to get to me and say, buy my thing, or download my ebook, or like my page on Facebook, if that floats your boat, this is what you have to penetrate to get there, which I think is tough. I think that's a really tough call. So if we're writing to individuals, if copywriting is about modifying the behavior of individuals, then what we need to do is to figure out what makes individuals tick. So I think copywriting is all about psychology, and one particular aspect of psychology I was kind of expecting a bit more of an aww to that. Copywriting is all about emotions. I've, you know, long believed this to be true. And in fact, you know, it was only in the latter part of my career that I've, or I suppose you should call it the middle part, that I began to work selling stuff to consumers. Most of my early career was spent in business to business, as I said. But I've always felt that we are selling to human beings. People buy from people is the old sort of sales adage. You know, can we have another show of hands? Who's in business to business here? And just see, okay, blimey, wow, okay. So you may have heard or you may have said, or someone said to you, oh, well, obviously it's different for us because we're selling to companies. Oh, good, there's some wise sort of head shaking going on. Companies don't buy things. Companies don't go to meetings. People do. I mean, you all work for companies and you all buy stuff. So when your business-to-business recipient gets a bit of your junk mail or your advertising, whatever it might be, they are driven by their emotions. And there are six primary emotions, and I've now sort of set my own bar incredibly high because I'm trying to remember them. Happiness, sadness, fear, anger, something beginning with D, I can't remember, and surprise. I'll come back to that one anyway. The point is, these are cross-culturally identified. People's faces register these six basic emotions in the same way. And if you're not tapping into one of these primary emotions, the old sort of fear, greed thing, you're making life very difficult for yourself, because there's something very interesting about emotions and decision-making. I've read a very interesting book recently by a Portuguese neuroscientist called Antonio Damasio, it's called The Feeling of What Happens. And it's all about consciousness and the role that emotion plays in consciousness. And he's done a lot of work, clinical work, you'd call it, so with patients who have damage to their brains. And a particular set of brain structures that he looks at is called the limbic system. Who knew? Brain diagrams at a writing conference. The limbic system is a set of interrelated discrete structures in the hind brain, what's called the paleomammalian brain. So for those of you with a classical education, you know that's the old mammal brain. So evolutionarily primitive part of the brain. You've got the thalamus and the hypothalamus, the amygdala, all these different little bits and bobs. And what they do is they process emotion and they register emotion. So when you see the puppy or the little kitten, the blue bit, so the cerebral cortex, the bit that deals with information that we all think is terribly important, especially in B2B. Oh yes, 80% of the B2B buying cycle is about information. May or may not be true, but I read it on Twitter, so it probably is true. It's completely dormant. When you see the puppy, in fact, when you decide to buy a puppy, this thing is quiet as the grave, and an MRI scan shows that this thing lights up like a traffic light. The limbic system goes into overdrive. So at the moment, we have a sort of correlative effect. But why it's interesting for us, I think, as copywriters, is because what Damasio and his colleagues found was when he had patients who had lesions, in other words, scarring or damage to the limbic system, here's what happened. The experimenters would present the patients with a scenario and said, which of these two decisions would be better for the person making this decision? Should they do this or should they do that? And these people could explain very coherently in logical terms which was the right course of action. And then they say, we're going to have a break now. You know, what would you like, tea or coffee? And these people were unable to make a decision. They couldn't decide something as trivial as what kind of drink to have, even though they were perfectly capable of processing the information to make a recommendation. Their own decision-making ability was completely destroyed. So that the seat of the emotions turns out to be the seat of decision-making as well. So when you start firing up somebody's limbic system by talking about puppies and kittens and all the rest of it, or protecting your kids, the decision gets made, and then this is happening in what's called cellular time. It's not a thing, I've decided that, now I need to use my cerebral cortex to justify it. But, you know, in a split second, the decision is taken and then information is processed to just almost check that that's what you need to do. I mean, I'm not a neuroscientist, and I've just probably completely traduced his work in about 3 minutes, but it's called The Feeling of What Happens. It's a very, very interesting book. What I'd like to do is give you a case study which kind of says one of the ways that you can engage people's emotions. It's probably no surprise if I say it's a storytelling. You know, storytelling, and incidentally, I hate the word story as a noun, as in the collective noun. I don't know why, it just annoys me, but storytelling. If you tell people a story, you're tapping into the limbic system immediately. You know, the human psychology has basically stayed virtually static over the last 300,000 years, which means that storytelling, which worked pretty well for teaching people important stuff about don't go out at night or a saber-toothed tiger will eat you, turns out to be still very effective today. So how do you do it? Well, our creative director, Joe Kelly, does a lot of pro bono work with a local hospital charity down in Salisbury. And they have a thing called the STARS Appeal. And the STARS Appeal organises fundraising for different things for the hospital, a children's A&E department, and at the moment, a CT scanner, you know, one of those big metal donuts that you go in and it sees through you. Here's the letter that Joe put together. So I'll just read you the first paragraph in case you're hard of seeing. How a CT scan saved my life. Dear Foundation Trust member, a few years ago, I found a lump on my neck. My daughter insisted I get it checked out. Despite various examinations and tests, no one could tell what it was till my doctor referred me to a specialist at Salisbury District Hospital who sent me for a CT scan. Within a couple of days of my scan, I had my diagnosis. My consultant told me I had Hodgkin's lymphoma, a type of cancer, which I'd probably had for some time, and that she wanted to start treatment very soon. That scan probably saved my life. And it goes on, and if anyone wants to see it, I can email it to you. And there's a PS that says, I had another CT scan 2 weeks ago and I got an all clear. It breaks some of the rules of direct marketing. There's no you in it, for a start, I don't think. It's all I. You know, we're told it's supposed to be three U's for every I, and yet here we have something written in the first person singular. But you can see why it works, because that opening sentence is just so powerful. It taps into a universal fear of dying, in fact, of cancer and the lump on the neck. It's almost a story in its own right. And this headline is actually a sort of classic advertising slash direct response approach. And Charlie Ross is, there's Charlie, he's a real person. Joe went and interviewed him. So it is his story. My only contribution to the whole thing was that on the back there was a list of bullet points, and I said you should put those back into narrative, because at that point it looks like it's gone into marketing speak, because Charlie Ross would never use bullet points. It's only corporate types who think bullet points are cool. And I want to show you the numbers as well, seeing as I said it's all about numbers. This is a great set of results. So we had a list size just a shade over 9,000. 500, and this is 3 weeks ago, incidentally. This thing is still pulling. It's got a really long tail on it. But 515 people responded, which means 5.6% response rate. This is good. I mean, this is unbelievably good. You know, I've checked with my sort of friends in charity marketing. This is a good, solid result from a diddy little hospital. Now, you could argue, and I'd agree with you, that it was a warm list. I mean, they're Foundation Trust members. But then again, this letter wasn't a soulless mailing. It went out with a newsletter from the hospital. I mean, maybe that's why it worked so well, because if you saw the newsletter, it's a very boring thing. Jo didn't charge for her services, and there was no postage, because it was a piggyback. So the total cost for production was £600. Look at that, though. 26,000 from an investment of 600. Seems almost pointless to say it, but 4,216% return on marketing investment. Most finance directors would find that acceptable, I think. You got any finance directors in the room who'd sort of nod? It's interesting. You know, one of our biggest clients at the moment, they just had a new CEO. Was he the ex-chief marketing officer or the ex-chief finance officer? Which do you think? Yes, of course. You often find that when companies want somebody to run themselves, they choose somebody from a financial background. That there's a glass ceiling for CMOs, and that's where it is. You know, it's very rare to find somebody who's spent their career briefing people like us being given the reins of a business. They much prefer somebody who knows that adding up sales and taking away costs is a really good thing to do. So, it's about numbers, it's about individuals, it's about emotions. What else is it about? I had to get one car slide into this session. Does anyone know what car this is? It's a Porsche. It's a 911. Now, this year is the 50th anniversary of the Porsche 911. There's one from 1963, so a little bit younger than I am, slightly better preserved. And this is one from 2013. Now, Porsche are often accused of only building one car. You know, it's got this particular shape. And in fact, it hasn't changed very much. I mean, you can see it's got a bit bigger, which may lead me neatly onto my next point. But essentially, Porsche engineers are trying to make this car do one thing, which is go around the Nürburgring track in Germany as fast as possible. That's its main thing. They're not particularly worried about Arab princes or bling. but can it go around the Nürburgring as fast as possible? And what they do is they keep trying different things. Or rather, they keep testing different things. And they test one thing at a time. So for years, the Porsche was an air-cooled thing, and then somebody said, well, maybe we should try or test water cooling. So in the 996 edition, they changed it, and they tested it, and they found out that it did make a difference. So they adopted it. Nobody at Porsche on the 911 program is allowed to do things because they like them or because they find it pleasing on the eye. It has a very aerodynamic shape that hasn't really changed in 50 years because in wind tunnels they found that's the one that works. So they just leave it like that. It has a rear-engined layout, which everybody says is stupid, but it's the best layout and it does what it's supposed to. And so in other words, this is all about testing, isn't it? And this is where I think direct response copywriting, direct mail, has probably made the biggest contribution to selling and to copywriting, is finding out what works better. And this word better is absolutely critical, incidentally. I don't think that copywriting is about what works. Everything works. A chocolate teapot works if you only put cold water into it. But maybe a China one would work better. And it's all about this constant iterative engineering process of testing one element of a campaign, one element of a promotion against another, you know, against a variant, and seeing which one makes that little pile of order forms grow just that little bit taller. And when I'm running kind of workshops and courses, people will often say to me, you know, if I've suggested something they don't like the thought of, well, we don't do that and it works for us. And I always have the same thing, well, yeah, but how much better would be it would be working if you did it properly? And or else, let's say, okay, that's fine, that's your opinion. Why don't we call that the basis for a testable hypothesis? You think this, I think this. We'll leave aside the fact that there's quite a lot of evidence that says this works already in books and whatnot. Why don't you test it? And usually people say things like, I don't need to test it, I know it won't work, which I think is fantastic. And say, how big's the list? And they say 200,000. I say, blimey, you can actually predict the behavior of 200,000 strangers. You know, why the hell are you working in a marketing department? You should be on TV, you could be like Dynamo or David Blaine. You actually know this isn't going to work in advance. Or, I don't like it, so I'm not going to test it. Well, even though I'm saying it will make you more profit, yeah, I really don't like it. It is this clash between the finance director brigade and the marketing director brigade that we find in this sort of profession or this trade, that some people are very focused on money and don't really care about anything else, and some people are very focused on the poem they wrote at infant school and never quite been able to sort of distance themselves from that. So I've learned a few things that have worked better over the years. I said I'd dug out from the Black Museum the first sales letter that I ever wrote. Here it is. This is a piece of ancient history, by the way. I think it's a pretty awful letter, actually. I'm not proud of it. I was only 22 at the time. And this is a classic killer sentence that I'll explain to you. Dear client, recent years have witnessed growing interest in healthy foods and healthy eating. Now, I'm sending this to the marketing director of Jordan's, presumably whose response was, no shit, you know, I'm the marketing director of Jordan's. And then there's some statistics, and against this background, you know, you can always hear me doing this, you know, against this background of growing interest, blah, 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 should be no surprise that, yes, I am the marketing director of Jordan's, I know this. And somewhere, is there a benefit? No, it gives you a wealth of statistics. There may be a galaxy of stars as well, but I'm not sure. It's all features. But, you know, it did all right, I suppose. The reason I put recent years of witness is because I went to my boss, Nicola Webb, and I said, I can't get started on this letter. And she said, oh, don't worry about that. What you do is you put recent years of witness, then you copy something out of the report. I thought this was the most brilliant time-saving tip I'd ever been told. I did dozens like this. You know, it took me a long time to realise that the reader was totally uninterested in this fact. 2013, slightly better known publishing house. This is one that we're working on right now. I think, a rather better first sentence, actually. Dear Mrs. Johnson, I have some good news for you. Oh, great, what is it? They both have the same typeface. It's called Courier, as I'm sure you all know. And I think we'll do maybe my third and last show of hands. Can you put your hands up if you like Courier? Can you put your hands up if you hate it? And then some abstentions. This is how it always goes. And, you know, people usually start throwing things at me in training courses if I say, use Courier, it's more profitable. If you read How to Write Sales Letters That Sell by Drayton Bird, which I think you should do, and if you haven't bought a copy, you should, because it's going out of print, he reveals the results of a test that said it was 20% more profitable than other typefaces. In tests. And I tell this to our clients, and do you know what they said? I don't care. What, you don't care you could make 20% more profit? No, I really don't like it. Or, better still, it's against our brand guidelines. Yes, because I've never seen a brand book that said you must use Courier. So every brand guidelines book on the planet is basically saying, avoid the most profitable typeface. You know, they say, oh, it's not, we have a very upmarket brand. I mean, Reader's Digest, fine, they're very downmarket, but, you know, we are so-and-so. Well, Condé Nast published The New Yorker, which is a very upmarket magazine. You won't find a single character set in Courier in the pages of The New Yorker. Guess what typeface they use for their direct mail? So you have to ask yourself, maybe Condé Nast is actually run by idiots. That's possible, isn't it? S.I. Newhouse, he could be a complete pillock, for all I know. But I suspect that a magazine that's been published continuously since the 20s and has advertising from Louis Vuitton and Hermès and Chanel and Mercedes-Benz and all the rest of it probably knows a little bit about making money. So we can leave that one, but if you're interested in maximising profits and you're using direct response, Courier is worth a test. That's as strongly as I would put it. Something else I've learned works better is, have I got time to get into a fight over this? Yes, I have. Long copy. It's great because I'm the first one on, so I get to give my opinion about long copy. And whatever you think, you just have to listen while I say it, which normally doesn't happen. So first thing to say is the debate has been misrepresented always. It's not about long copy at all. It's not about long copy outpulling short copy. It's about longer copy outpulling shorter copy. And the reason is, who knows what long copy is? Is 300 words long copy? Have a show of hands. It might be on a poster. It might be if you were testing it against 30 words. But if you were testing it against 3,000 words, 300 words to me doesn't look like long copy. It looks like shorter copy. So what I'm saying is, if you were testing an ad that had 25 words of copy and you doubled the amount of copy to 50, I'd be willing to bet in a test that the ad with 50 words of copy would bring in more orders. And in fact, there was this completely sort of bogus hoo-ha on Twitter recently about Apple and their long copy ads. Those ads have got 124 words, and that's not long copy. I mean, it was execrable copy in any case. It was self-aggrandizing rubbish. You know, it's a company driven by features. You know, Jonathan Ives is the reason that Apple is successful. It's got nothing to do with their, you know, TBWA and their poignant advertising campaign. I read that the other day. You know that something bad is happening when advertising bloggers are talking about computer companies advertising as poignant. But in any case, the debate has been misrepresented. It's longer versus shorter. And I've read a stack of tests and conducted a stack of tests over the last 30 years. And they all point one way. And what's interesting is when people say, oh, well, you know, I can't believe people read long copy. And it's like, well, I don't know how to respond to that. Where's the evidence then? Where are the books by Caples and Bill Birnbach and Ogilvy and Eugene Schwartz and everybody else saying, the one thing you must do is write short copy because it will make you more money? There aren't any. You'd think by now that some bright spark would have published a book overturning 120 years of advertising wisdom because they'd be on all the talk shows. So I think the point is, it's not about what we like, it's about what works better. And the way to find out what works better is to test it. And I don't have time to go into the science of testing, and it involves words like statistical significance and standard deviations and 95% confidence. There's a very good and simple explanation in Drayton's other book, Common Sense Direct and Digital Marketing. That's the one I'd advise you to buy if you want to see how to do it. Have an opinion. Have an incredibly strong opinion, but simply use it as the basis for a testable hypothesis. Don't ignore, you know, I say, don't leave money on the table just because you don't like a typeface. I have a client who says, I hate Courier, use it on all our promotions. And she herself has tested it and found that they get better responses. So, I suppose I ought to make some sort of nod to the title of my speech about the cutting edge, having a bone handle. This is, people aren't as rude to me as this, or probably as I am to them, but this is the sort of subtext of what I hear a lot of the time. You know, this is, come on man, this is 2013, it's the web. People have short attention spans, therefore you have to do X, Y, and Z. Again, where is this evidence for short attention spans? I was standing outside my hotel yesterday, waiting for a cab, and there were six people on their internet, on their phones, doing this. And I thought, well, they don't look like they've got short attention spans. I don't know about you, I can spend hours on Twitter. So I don't have a short attention span. I've got two kids, sort of 11 and 10, they will spend hours on Minecraft. I looked at our Google Analytics the other day, two people spent an average of 13 and a half minutes on one of my blog posts. Doesn't sound like a short attention span to me, it sounds like quite a long attention span. I can tell you exactly how long the human attention span is in the age of the internet. It's the same length it's always been, which is the length of time it takes to read something they find continuously interesting, and not a second longer. Probably the only sort of game-changing technology is hypertext, because that, you know, people can literally jump around from one to the other. But I want to close with I've only got one visual aid today, but it's a good one. Has the web changed anything? Have we got anyone in from Agora today? Yeah, the Agora crew, okay. Agora is a very interesting company, started by a guy called Bill Bonner. Three things I know about Bill Bonner is he's very clever, he's very rich, and he's a very good copywriter. And he's built an empire on long copy. So, I need someone brave. I need a volunteer from the audience. And I've only got 4 minutes and 52 seconds left, so I need one quickly. Thank you, lady over there in the blonde hair. Yes. What's your name?
Mel.
This is Mel. This is a promotion that Agora are running through one of their subsidiaries called Fleet Street Publications right now. Okay? Mel, could you just take that edge for me and just very carefully start to walk in that direction? Slow down. Thank you. A big round of applause for my beautiful assistant, Mel. So when it comes to writing for the web, there's no school like an old school. Thank you very much. I think we have a little bit of time for questions, if anyone has. We've got a roving mic. Is it on?
Hello.
Hi.
Courier in email marketing, same?
We haven't tested that. I mean, the received wisdom until quite recently was that serif faces work better offline and sans serif faces work online because the serifs are supposed to be harder to render. But, you know, I mean, my iPad's got a Retina display, so has my iMac. I suspect that as screen resolutions get to the sort of quality of old school litho, at the very least, it would be an interesting test. And I have seen courier popping up on websites from time to time now. Who knows? It would be worth a test.
What is it about courier? Why courier? As opposed to all the other hundreds of thousands of fonts that are out there?
In a nutshell, I think because it speaks to a sort of atavistic desire for a simpler world when people actually used to spend time writing to each other on typewriter. There's a sort of authenticity about it. It's very unpolished. The sort of thing that drives designers crazy, which is its lack of polish, is precisely what makes it work, I think, because it looks unslick. I was talking to another, I have so many, neuroscientist friend in the States, and her sort of take on it was it's a monospace typeface, so it's not kerned. In other words, every character takes up the same space, and it has very pronounced serifs. So you're getting a very strong visual railway from left to right on the page, which means that it's keeping the reader's eye tracking one line at a time, which means they're going to take in more of what you've written, which may mean that that's why it works. The trouble with direct response, and it's the difference between analysis and research, is nobody really knows why it works. They just know that it does work. And so simple souls like me, if you find out that something does work or better, we tend to go, oh, great, we'll do that then. People say, well, why does it work? I don't know. I'm just counting order forms. That's what I've done for 30 years. One at the front.
Hi, Andy. I'm proof that you can teach an old dog new tricks. And I've got, with your book, Right to Sell, the big thing that I did, I actually changed to Garamond, which is like a curly typeface. And I tested it on four really hard-assed southern guys a few weeks ago. Compared to the typeface they were using, it's like, oh, we love that one. We don't know why, but we love it. And they went for the Garamond, even though they've been using quite a harsh Arial font. And I definitely think that's a much more attractive, easy to read, a curly. So am I doing the right thing? Yeah. Did I follow your instructions to the letter?
Yeah, I mean, I'm, you know, as they say, standing on the shoulders of giants. I mean, anyone from sort of Ogilvy or, you know, John Cables or Drayton onwards would say, if you can't do Courier, do Times. And, you know, Garamond and Bembo and Palatino and all these serif faces, they look old-fashioned, which is again why designers tend not to like them. But go out and find me a newspaper that's printed in a sans-serif typeface, and I'll start thinking differently about typography. But the world's entire newspaper industry has settled on Times and a few of its sort of stablemates because they're highly readable. And that's why it works, because comprehension goes up. One last. I mean, I'm around all day, so it doesn't have to be the last moment. But.
If you're trying to engage with a technical audience, even a kind of scientific audience, who you would assume would be more interested in the rational reasons for doing something, how does the sort of emotional side of things come in? But what? Where would emotion, play a role in terms of engaging with a much more cerebral sort of audience?
It's a good question, and I think the answer is that it's in the detail. The way we write copy at Sunfish is I would always plan it first and figure out what sort of emotional response I'm trying to arouse. But, you know, scientists subscribe to the Reader's Digest, scientists read The Sun, scientists buy ice cream, and scientists have affairs, get pissed, and take illegal drugs. So I assume that they're just as much a prey to their emotions and their limbic systems as all the rest of us. They may have a persona, if you like. They may have a sense of self that says, emotions are for other people. But unless they're a different species and not just a different job, then I think they're exactly the same. It may be that in your phraseology, you just dial it down a bit. So thank you all very much, and I hope to talk to you all a bit later. Thank you.